Father God, I just ask that you meet us all where we're at today, whether we're struggling, whether we're not. Just meet us where we're at. Open our hearts and prepare us for your word so that we can soak it in and take that into the world and use it as a light to reach the people out here and help them to come and see your glory and your love. And I ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. And I just want to say to you this morning as we get this awesome chance to worship God. Well, first of all, congratulations. You made it. You beat the pylons. Nothing stops us as we go for the Lord and worship. Amen, church? And if you are with us today for the first time, I want to say to you how wonderful it is to have you here. Welcome to Scottsdale Christian Church.
To bring you I give you control. Consume me from the inside. Let justice separate. Become my embrace. To love you from the inside. Well, everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fate. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out, Lord. My soul cries out, everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fate. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out, Lord. My soul rise out from the inside.
Give a shout out to Jesus, church. Amen. Yeah. Praise you, God. And please be seated.
Well, as a church, we have a mission. Our mission is to make Jesus known, to let people know that Jesus Christ is real, that he loves them, and he wants to be in a relationship with him. And the problem is, when I tell people that all of us have that responsibility, people get freaked out a lot of times. They think that the sharing their faith, that being involved in evangelism means I have to go meet a stranger, I have to talk to them about things that are very uncomfortable, they're going to ask me a bunch of questions I don't know, I've got to get them to church this Sunday and baptize them Sunday afternoon, it all has to happen right now. And that's not what it is. It almost never, ever works out that way. Instead, we look at people and where they are with their walk with God. You know, kind of on a scale type of a thing. You know, on the zero side, people that are living far from God, God's not even on their radar. They're just kind of living life, doing their own thing, with no concept, no thoughts at all about the future or who God is. And then it kind of goes to people who are seeking. They may not even know what they're seeking. They just start thinking, you know what, there's more to this life than just the stuff I see. There's got to be more. I wonder what it could be. And then there are those people who are exploring. They're exploring Christianity. They're getting into this and saying, okay, I hear people talk about God. I hear about Jesus. And what does this all mean? And then there are disciples. People that have made that decision to commit to Jesus, and then the fully committed. The people that don't just play, you know, the fully committed people that show up to church even on Marathon Sunday. And so as you're looking through, as you're talking with people, this is not an exact scale. Those numbers are not exact, but part of our purpose when we're sharing our faith and living out our faith in a mission-minded way is not necessarily to get people from 0 to 10 in the next 3 hours. It may be in the conversation, the interaction that we have with them, we move them up one notch and call that a win. There were this series that we're doing, it's about helping people move up that scale, helping us help people move up that scale. And we're going to start with a story from the New Testament with Peter and John. They were both apostles of Jesus Christ. And there was one time that they were going to worship God at the temple. As they're going along, they see this guy begging at the temple gates. He's been crippled since he was born. Peter and John have walked by this guy probably hundreds of times in the past. But something happened this day. Something got their attention, and the guy was asking for money, and Peter said, you know what, don't have any money, but what I do have, think you're going to like. And so Peter was able to heal the guy. Well, the guy started following Peter and John around because he's kind of happy. You know, he's been crippled since birth, and all of a sudden he can start walking. So he's walking, jumping, praising God right there in the middle of the temple, and it draws a crowd. People start looking around going, what's going on? And Peter, being the preacher that he is, sees the crowd drawing, so he says, you know what? Let's have a little sermon. And so he starts preaching about Jesus Christ. And as he does that, the religious authorities of the day, they don't like that message because it's against them, because they're the ones that were against Jesus Christ. And so they take Peter and John, throw them in prison, and then the next day they bring them and they put them on trial. And that's kind of where we're going to pick up this story, is Peter and John in front of the Sanhedrin, okay? So if you have a Bible this morning, turn to Acts chapter 4. If you don't have a Bible, there should be one of the chairs in front of you. It's page 772. You can find Acts 4 on your YouVersion or some Bible app on your phone or tablet. Or if you have your own Bible, Acts is kind of toward the end of the Bible, after the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and then the book of Acts, right before Romans. So Acts chapter 4, as we're going through this, there's going to be five principles for us to put into practice in our life where we can be mission-minded. And the first principle is we have to care for people. We have to care for people. As Peter is making his defense before the Sanhedrin, chapter 4, verse 8, it says, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a cripple and are asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. He is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the capstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. We're going to stop there for right now. Go back in verse 9. In verse 9, Peter says, if we're being called to account today, if you've got us on trial today because of an act of kindness to a cripple, well, here's what's going on. And it just starts just with that thought. Peter and John notice this man. I don't know what happened in the past, but there's something about this day that they saw him, they noticed him, they paid attention, and they wanted to help this guy. You know, for us today, we have to see the people that we interact with on a daily basis. We have to see them as real people. You know, this stuff that we teach in here on Sunday mornings, the stuff that we preach and teach in small groups, we have to believe that this stuff is really real. We have to believe that heaven is real. We have to believe that hell is real. We have to believe that a relationship with God is beneficial. That's not just something that we do to fill time, but it's beneficial. We have to see that people who don't have Jesus are missing out. We have to have that mindset. And that when you come into contact with people every day, what do you see? Do you see just crowds of people? Or do you see individuals who need Jesus Christ? When Jesus was on this earth, man, he had crowds all the time. And in Matthew chapter 9, verse 36, it says this, when Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. When Jesus saw the crowds, he saw all these people out there. He didn't just say, well, you know, it stinks to be them. You know, man, they should go and do something else, you know. He had compassion on them. Why? Because they were harassed and helpless. They were people that life had gotten into them, you know. And it was not full of hope and promise like it had been, but they were down. They were depressed. They were in some way, things were not going well for them. And Jesus had compassion on them. He cared for them. And so the question for us today is, when we are going through our everyday life, whether it's at the grocery store or work or wherever, do we see just crowds of people or do we see the individuals? And if we see individuals, do we have compassion on them? Do we care? You know, especially those people in our lives who are rude, annoying, and obnoxious. You know, those people we see and we notice them and we want to kick them out. You know, but our attitude, we need to think about that and say, you know what? There's probably a reason why these people are rude, annoying, and obnoxious. Maybe things are not going well in their life. Maybe they don't have God in their life. Maybe they don't understand that the God of this universe loves them. And they need someone to take the time to love them into a relationship with Christ. They're seeking something to fill the emptiness that's there. And so when we go through life, we need to do what Jesus did. We need to care for people. We need to not just see people as numbers, but we need to care for individual people. That's what Peter and John were doing. They said, hey, you guys are calling us into account today for an act of kindness to this cripple? Well, let me tell you. And so then the next thing that we can do that they did is we can take a stand for Jesus. We can take a stand. In verse 10, if we're being called into account for an act of kindness, then know this. You and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. When they were called to testify, they didn't say, well, here's the deal. We've been given these miraculous powers recently, and we're able to heal people. It's kind of cool. So we just go around healing people randomly, so everyone comes and sees how great we are. And so my name's Peter, and I'll be here all week. Okay? I mean, that's not the attitude at all. Peter and John's attitude was, this is about Jesus Christ. I'm just a vessel. He's just using me. It's not about me. It's about Jesus Christ. You know, there's a lot of good organizations in this world. There's a lot of people in this world who do good things. That's all great. But as Christians, as followers of Jesus Christ, we're supposed to do good things as well, but it's to bring glory to God and not ourselves. The things that we do that are good for other people, those are things that we need to acknowledge at some point, in some fashion, that we're not doing it because we're just a random good person. We're doing it because of our relationship with Jesus Christ. In Matthew 5, verse 16, Jesus says it this way. He says, in the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. See, Jesus gives us this command. Let the people around you know, let them know that God's real by the things that you do. Do good things for other people. That's how you let your light shine. And when you do those good things, make sure that you acknowledge it's because of Jesus Christ that I'm doing this. This last week, I was at Walmart, went early in the morning, and as I'm getting out of my car and going in, I see this guy, and he's on his cell phone, and he's talking on his cell phone outside of his car. And I'm thinking, all right, well, that's a little strange, but, you know, I've got stuff to do. And so I go in, I get my stuff, dude, I come back out. Still on his cell phone, still outside of his car. And I'm like, all right. And so I go, okay, hey, do you need some help? Are you locked out of your car? And he goes, he's on his phone, he's like, all right, I got to go. Some dude's talking to me about helping me with my car. And so he hangs up, and sure enough, he's locked out, and it's an old beater car, and I know how to break into cars like this. So I'll help you out this morning in case you have a friend who locks himself out of their car. And so I just went to my van, grabbed a couple tools, grabbed a couple screwdrivers, pried the door open, took the antenna off my car, and stuck it down through the side to push the door locks. And it was a little bit more complicated than that, but basically that's how you break into a car, as long as they have the electric door locks. So now you know. But I'll tell you, it took us a little while to get to it, but it was kind of fun to do. And when we got the lock and it popped, I mean, there was like rejoicing. It was like, yes, it works, you know? And that's cool. And if you've ever helped someone like this, you know what I'm saying. There was just this cool thing. And he was so grateful. He was so thankful. He's like, hey, man, thanks so much. You know, appreciate it and all this stuff. And I'm like, hey, not a problem. Anytime I can break into a car, it's a good day for me, you know? And then I drove off. And I'm just like, you know, that was cool. I was able to help this guy out. And then the preacher voice hit in there. And I'm like, dude, what an opportunity that I missed. What an opportunity. I'm helping this guy break into a car. And we get it done. And all I had to say was something like, you know what? Not a problem. Jesus just wants me to help people out. Or I'm a Christian, and if there are ways that I can help people out, I want to do that. All I had to say was just one little sentence, and I blew it. And it made this story that was really cool for me in the morning. It just made me go, dang, why didn't I take that stand for Jesus? I didn't even give the guy my name, so I wasn't trying to glorify me, but I was neutral. I didn't glorify God. Peter and John, they remind us to be mission-minded. Because when they are on trial for their lives, in a real sense, they said, hey, it's because of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that this guy was healed. That's what God calls us to do as well. The third principle is this, is that you need to confront your fear. When it comes to being mission-minded and sharing your faith, the thing that you need to do, you need to confront your fear. In verse 13, it says this about Peter and John. When the Sanhedrin saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished. They were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. When they saw the courage of Peter and John, and I think about that, and I'm like, well, Peter and John, they weren't lawyers standing on in front of the Supreme Court. They weren't professional clergy who could, you know, do all this special stuff and have all this stuff memorized. All they had to talk about was the truth of what had happened in their lives over the last 3 years. And the truth of what had happened over the last 3 years in their lives, that's what gave them courage. What they had done with Jesus Christ and what they had seen and what they, the conversations they'd had, the relationship that they had with him, that's what gave them the courage to stand up, uneducated fishermen, and to stand up in front of this group. What about you? What are you afraid will happen if you tell somebody about Jesus? I mean, I've heard the different things. I mean, you know, we get afraid to mention the name of Jesus because people will think that I'm weird. Honestly, they already do, all right? So let's just skip that one, okay? Well, what are you afraid will happen if you start talking to someone about Jesus? You're afraid that you won't know the answer? They're going to ask you questions you don't know the answer to? Well, number one, if you start talking to people about Christ, and they start asking you questions. Number one, I think you're going to be surprised by the things you do know. And that's kind of cool. Because they start asking you questions, and you're like, I know that one. But when they get to the ones you don't know, I can help you out with this. Here's what you say. Can I get back to you? The nice thing about not being professional clergy is your friends don't expect you to have all the answers. And so when you say, man, I don't know, can I get back to you on that? Then you go and you Google it, or you talk to your small group leader, you talk to me or whoever, and you get the answer and you go back. And the cool thing is, it helps you start the second conversation. Because you say, hey, you asked me about this that one time. Well, I know it's been a few days or a week or two, but I found out the answer. Let's talk about that. Bam. Right into the second conversation. Or sometimes people are afraid of, what if I mess it up? Like I'm talking to them about Christ and I mess it up and they're going to hell. And it's like, really? The Almighty God of the universe brought you two together for this conversation and you're going to screw it up so bad that he can't fix it. Is that what you're thinking? We need to have a little conversation about God's power, all right? So we'll talk right after the service, me and you. And I think he is big enough to deal with any mistakes. Well, what are you afraid of? Sometimes people, you just don't know how to start. How do I start the conversation? Well, you know what? So many times, for me, it's just starting with things that you know. You know, when you go to work on Monday and people say, how was your weekend? We'll say, oh, it's cool. We had this event at the church. You know, and it was a really cool one. And a lot of people came and we got to do this, that, and the other. Or you can say, well, you know, I went to church Sunday. It was Marathon Sunday, so it took me an extra hour to get there, but our preacher is so worth it. It was so good, you know? And you can lie in that way, and God will forgive you for it. It's not a problem. Oh, you just tell them about your life. You tell them about what God has done in your life. I mean, that's an easy way to start the conversation. That's what Peter and John did. But 1 Peter 3, verse 14. Peter says this, even if you should suffer for what is right, even if you should suffer for what is right, you're blessed. Even if you're talking to someone and they just start mocking you and throwing rocks at you and they lock you in the local jail because you're standing up for Christ, you're blessed. Do not fear what they fear. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, set apart Christ as Lord, as Master, as boss. And always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have, but do it with gentleness and respect. One of the easiest ways to overcome fear is to be prepared. It's to know what you're going to say. And I think that's probably one of the things that a lot of people don't, they're just not ready for it. One of the biggest ways that I try to encourage people to overcome their fear is just, I just tell you, to write out your story. Write out your story on one piece of paper, okay? And write out your story. Your story is pretty simple. Here is what my life used to be like. Here's why I came to Christ. And here's what my life is like now. And if you do it on one piece of paper, number one, you'll remember it even if you don't have the piece of paper, okay? Because it's your story. Number two, it keeps you brief. Have you ever gone to someone's house and watch the slideshow of their vacation? And after about 5 minutes, you're like, dang, somewhere I got to be. Well, there are people that tell their stories, and it takes them half an hour to get through the story, and people checked out after like 6 minutes. And so if you write your story on one piece of paper, it helps you to be brief. People like it when we're brief, and if they want to ask you follow-up questions, guess what? They'll ask you. If they're tired of hearing about it, they won't. But to overcome fear, write out your story, be prepared. Be prepared to have the answers. That's one of the greatest things to overcome fear. To be mission-minded means that we're caring for people, we're standing for Jesus, we're confronting our fear, and ultimately it means that we're obeying God. We obey God. What happened next is the Sanhedrin, they didn't know what to do. Because here's these unschooled, uneducated guys standing up with courage and boldness, preaching to the religious leaders of the day. And so they kick them out for a little bit. They have a little meeting, and they talk about what they're going to do. They call them back in. And in verse 18, it says, they called them in again and commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. All right, we're not going to do anything else. You don't have to pay any fines. You don't have to go to jail. You're not going to get flogged. So, you know, it's a good day for you, but you just need to stop talking about Jesus. And Peter and John replied, you judge for yourselves whether it's right in God's sight to obey you rather than God. For we cannot help speaking about what we've seen and heard. Peter says, man, we got a choice here. We can obey you guys who could fine us, you could flog us, you could throw us in jail, or we could obey God who, I don't know, can get us to heaven. Seems pretty simple. And then he said, you know, we can't help it. We can't help speaking about the things that we've seen and heard. As followers of Jesus, we have a responsibility to obey the authorities, the government authorities, the police. We have a responsibility to obey them. As long as those laws don't conflict with God's laws. And then God's laws take precedent. If you call yourself a follower of Jesus Christ, if you call yourself a Christian, you say, I'm a follower of Christ. If you call yourself that, then this is a part of what you do. This is a part of the job description, telling people about Christ. In Luke chapter 11, verse 28, Jesus said this, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and obey it. Blessed are those who hear the word of God. That's what you're doing right now. You're hearing the word of God. But blessed are those who do the word of God. Blessed are we when we obey. We simply obey. You know, I go to, you know, a lot of you guys know about the Solomon Foundation. It's a finance group that's helped our church out in some of the past. Some of you guys have money invested with them. We do. I go to their seminars every year or two, and they have it different places. Well, one of the guys that's on the board for the Solomon Foundation is this old guy named Mac. Now, I don't know exactly how old he is, but he moves kind of slow. He's got a nice head of gray hair, and Mac just looks like just kind of this ordinary guy. But what Mac does is whenever he gets to the hotel, wherever the conference is, he starts talking to the people behind the desk. Or he starts talking to the waiter or the waitress. Or he starts talking just to whoever he can find. It's like he just kind of looks around and says, there's someone not doing anything. I'm going to go start talking to them. And so he does. And he starts talking about them. And somehow he always brings the conversation around to asking them things like, well, do you go to church somewhere? Or do you believe in God? And I tell you what, in the few times I've seen him, I have always seen him on a weekend talking to someone about God, about religion, about the church. You know how he does it? He goes up and starts talking. That's it. Pretty crazy. He saw that our mission as followers of Christ is to talk to people about Jesus Christ, to bring them into a relationship. And so he just says, all right. And if you ask him if he's doing anything special, he's going to say, no, I'm not doing anything special. Just being obedient. I'm just obeying what God told me to do. And then if you suffer still, if you still don't know if you can really make this happen or you don't know all these things, the fifth thing that you can do, the fifth principle here is to pray for boldness. Pray for boldness. Back there at Acts 4, they let him go. They threatened Peter and John some more, and they let him go. And so Peter and John went back to the church, and they told them what all had happened. And then they prayed to God. I'm not going to do the whole prayer, but I'll pick it up in verse 27. Herod and Pontius Pilate met together. They're praying to God and saying, together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in the city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. God, you weren't surprised by this. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. You know, when we're threatened, so many times I think that we kind of shrink back and just say, wow, if they're going to do that, then I just got to be careful. And most of the times our prayer is, God, just help us be safe in this situation. God, you see the stuff that they want to do to me. You see the way the opposition is there. And so, God, just help me to be safe. But the apostles didn't pray for safety. They said, God, help us to be bold. Help us to speak your word with great boldness. We hear their threats, and we don't want to be intimidated by that. Instead, we want to share with them the truth. We don't want to back down from this. If all of this stuff about sharing your faith, it just seems scary, then ask God to give you boldness to fulfill his mission. Don't ask that he gives the church boldness. Ask that he gives me boldness. At this point, you don't care what anyone else in the church does. You want to be obedient. You want to obey Christ, and you want to be bold for him, whether or not anyone else does. You know, it's one of our prayers. It's one of the things that God wants us to do. And there's some really good reasons for it. In the tiny little book of Philemon, Paul writes and says this. He says, I pray that you may be active in sharing your faith so that you will have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ Jesus. Paul writes and says, you know, I want you to be active in sharing your faith because we win people to Christ that way, but also it helps you in your walk with Christ because you come to have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. Because people ask you questions about your faith and you're able to answer some of them. And the ones you can't answer, you go and you find and you share the answer and then you remember those answers. When you're active in sharing your faith, you talk to people whose lives are a mess. And they come and they talk to you, and you're like, dang, God, thank you so much, because that's where I used to be. But now I'm not. And you come to have a full understanding of all the good things. You mature in your faith. You rely on God in new ways, in ways you've never relied on before. I'm not saying it's going to be easy. I'm not saying it's not going to be scary at times. But you grow up and you mature in your faith. You see, it always amazes me when someone says that they're not growing in their faith. Because what they do when they're not growing in their faith is they tend to blame the church, or more specifically, they blame the pastor. And you hear this from people. Well, I was going to that church for a long time, but I left because I just wasn't being fed anymore. And what that usually means, it may be true on occasion. It may be true that you go to a church and they don't talk about the Bible at all. Okay, you're not being fed spiritually. I'll give you that. But for 99% of the people that leave a church because they're not being fed, it's not because of that. It's because of an obvious lack of boldness on their part. Their preacher gets up and says, hey, you need to tell people about Jesus Christ. It's a part of the job of being a Christian. And they go, oh, yeah, I should do that. And they never have the conversation. And then they can't figure out why they haven't hit the next level in their faith. They can't find out why they're not growing spiritually. They can't figure out why it doesn't seem like God's speaking to them. They've grown as much as they can up to here. And until you take that next step, move up the scale a notch, guess what? You're not going to grow in your faith. So stop blaming the church. Stop blaming the pastor. Stop blaming God. And be obedient to the things he's done. That he tells you to do. Pray for boldness so that you can be active in sharing your faith. That's what he's calling us to do. When you look at Peter and John, they were mission-minded. They had their focus on making Jesus known. That means that we have to care for people, that we have to stand for Jesus, we have to confront our fears, we have to obey God, and we pray. Most of us are mission-minded about something. Most of us are mission-minded about something. It may be movies. It may be sports. It may be restaurants. It may be bands. When we see one that we like and we enjoy, we are all over Facebook. We are texting friends. We are posting videos. We are very evangelistic and mission-minded about some things. I'm just saying we need to be mission-minded about Jesus. And we don't know what the results are going to be. We don't know how he's going to work. But he's going to work in some crazy ways. Such as. Went to a meeting this last Tuesday. And the meeting was just over here at Sky Song. And the meeting, it was a culmination of 15 months of work. There's an organization that started by some local people here in South Scottsdale who said, you know what, South Scottsdale has been pretty run down. We want to help build it up. And so for 15 months, they spent tens of thousands of dollars. They've knocked on 15,000 doors. They've done online surveys of 2,500 people. They've done 15 focus groups. And they're trying to figure out who all lives in South Scottsdale, what they like, and what those people want so that they can rebrand South Scottsdale. Because Scottsdale has the air park up north. It's got the old town. But this part of Scottsdale has just a bad reputation. So they want to rebrand the city. And so at the meeting Tuesday, they were revealing a lot of their information, a lot of their data, and all this stuff. And it was cool to see those things. And then they unveiled their new logo, and their new logo looks like this. It's a hummingbird, and you look at the logo, and right afterwards, I went up to one of the presenters, and I showed him my business card. I said, man, I really like your new logo, because our logo looks like yes. So it's the same font, the same color scheme. Go back to the first one. We both have a kind of a little wavy thing going in there. Back to ours. Oh, yeah. So it took them 15 months and tens and thousands of dollars, and God got us with our logo here 8 months before theirs showed up. That's the kind of crazy stuff that happens when you try and make Jesus known. And it was so funny to watch them because they were so shocked and it was so hilarious because they're like, I mean, because they had a major marketing person over there who was doing a part of this presentation. And here's this church sitting on the corner that they've never even seen. That's the kind of stuff God does when we have the conversation. I could tell you a lot of conversations that have happened that I've had with people that I'm having this conversation, and God just brought the two things together in ways that I never could have planned. And you just look back at that and go, God, you're just hilarious. Because there's no way this could happen on my own. There's no way that we could plan for this. That's how we grow and mature in our faith. God, thank you. Thank you so much that you're active, that you're involved in our lives. Thank you, God, for your love for us. And God, I pray that you will help us to be obedient, to follow you. And we do that because you tell us to. And we do it because we care and are concerned about the eternity of the people that live around us. God, help us to be bold for you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
All right. Thanks, Brian. Please stand with us. Sing this with us. Here we go.
Ooh. 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 Bring your time and bring your strength. Bring your gift and bring your pain. Don't you know that's not your name?
Let's go! you. See you in 10 minutes.